I am Narinka Saxena, representing a Apex Industry Chamber of the country, FICCI. And we run many programs on innovation and especially for the social impact. I'm here to speak about Millennium Alliance. I'd like to give you a spread. Millennium Alliance, we started in 2011. And how we started is my Secretary General then, Dr. Rajiv Kumar, went to US and met the US Administrator, Dr. Shah. And he said, India don't need any aid at this stage. We are now developing. And we need US and other countries to become as a development partner to this program. And with that intent, we signed up a MOU with USAID as a partner, and we got Government of India on the board and started this a wonderful initiative for bottom-up pyramid for $50 million. Very proud to inform you today we have World Bank as a knowledge partner, DFID as a partner, UKAID, we have ICICI Bank as a partner through their foundation. Many other foundations are joining, and shortly a Citibank is joining on the board. And what we have created a unique opportunity for social entrepreneurs is a capital which they can access through our platform. We also bring industry experiences, and since in our term, we have been running this program for a similar program for the last 15 years. What we feel that creating a capital is very important for social entrepreneurship. And India is a true development platform where we have 0.68 billion people living under $1. And we can test the model, we can innovate the model, we are a democratic platform, government policies are good, FICCI brings government on the board, private sector on the board, and those models we can replicate outside. And happy to inform you through our a global partnership connect, UKAID, has taken many innovations to Africa and region. Shortly, two more opportunities are coming to Millennium Alliance, which I want to brief you that BRIC, this summit, is going to happen in India in October. They are going to set up a $50 million for social entrepreneurship. And FICCI will be the lead. And we like to connect Millennium Alliance, our work with BRIC platform, which our country is the host country this year. Second, I am a co-chair of United Nations on disaster risk reduction. So for the Asia. So we have told that, in fact, in their Sendai framework, which is a 2030 framework, we have mentioned about Millennium Alliance, a unique platform to access to private sector and NGOs for any kind of social businesses where disaster risk reduction is a very, very core area. And shortly, we are in discussion with UNDRR. We will be setting up some unique funding, which we will bring to Millennium Alliance to access to our friendly social entrepreneurs. These opportunities, I wish you all the best for thinking.
Thank you very much, Mr. Saxena. Can I thank you? I mean, we're going to move into a more discussion format in a few minutes and call out some of the details that of the Millennium Alliance program, but thank you for that introduction. I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Stowicki, Program Manager for the Africa Enterprise Challenge Fund, to talk a little bit about the mandate for the Africa Enterprise Challenge Fund. What are the organizations you focus on, and sort of why you're thinking?
Thank you. So I represent the AECF, the Africa Enterprise Challenge Fund, which is based out of Nairobi, Kenya. And the Africa Enterprise Challenge Fund is indeed one of the largest funds of this type in Africa and possibly globally. We support companies, for-profit businesses, across Africa, which work primarily in agribusiness, agriculture, adaptation to climate change, and renewable energy. Now, many of those businesses are essentially, in effect, financial services businesses because of the way they structure the financing of products and services that they develop for low-income communities. To date, we've made more than 200 investments across 23 different markets. And the AECF is many things to many people. We are a development fund. We support businesses, innovative businesses, social enterprises. But we're also a FISA fund. So many private equity funds, commercial banks, impact investors, they see us, AECF, as a feeder fund, because the companies that we invest in, once they graduate from our program, so to speak, after a few years, typically 6 years, many of them are very attractive, very interesting for more commercially oriented investors. So we are also a feeder fund. We are an innovation fund at the end of the day as well, because we are supporting innovation. We believe that only innovation can bring large numbers of people out of poverty. So we support innovation. We take on a risk which commercially oriented investors wouldn't take on, precisely because it is so risky. Innovation, as you all know by default, is something new, something unknown. So we don't really operate in the same space at the time we're investing in the companies, in the same space as the commercially oriented investors do. So it is also very important for us not to distort the market by giving grants and then soft loans and de facto competing with commercially oriented investors. We don't do that. We provide funding to companies which would otherwise find very, very difficult to access funding from commercial banks or private equity funds. I think we will talk a little more later on during the discussion. I think I'll stop here.
Yes, that's great. Thank you for that overview. Thank you very much. So I'd like to now move to Mr. Faisal Hussain from the UNCDF, focused on South and Southeast Asia, to describe their program in a little bit more detail and the data-driven methodology that they use.
Thank you. I think to start off with, and just to create some boundaries of what we do, we have shared many similar things to the Africa Challenge Fund in that we support primarily large companies and try and figure out how we can get them to solve particular development challenges. So for us, much more important is, for us the problem is, how do we increase better financial solutions to women? So that's the core element of our work. It's not about building social enterprises, it's actually the opposite. Because we're not supporting social enterprises, we're supporting established institutions. Now, I think for us, the distinctions are important because our experience has been that if we have to build capacity while we try and incentivize, it becomes very difficult to build capacity. So we're trying to solve the scale problem by picking institutions who have fairly deep balance sheets, who are able to deploy those balance sheets after the sort of experiments to the challenge. For us, what's important is to figure out why companies are not willing to make investments, and usually they don't have enough information or data, and they feel that that particular information asymmetry produces so much risk that the board just doesn't want to make investments in a product or a service. So for us, when we come in with funding for the challenge, it's only to change the risk-adjusted returns for that institution so that we're able to get them to make an investment. So that's one. The other distinction, I know we're getting slightly into the, but other distinction is that we don't fund institutions, which is where a lot of social investments are. We fund projects. And three is that we don't fund winners, we just start races, because we have no idea.
Is that from us?
Yes.
We don't pick winners, we start races.
Oh, there you go. There you go. So there's lots of similarities, as I said, with the African Challenge. So we have no idea who's going to win. I think we're going to come back to it in a minute. One of the things we've discovered is that actually funding comes way after in terms of trying to figure out what institutions can do. Because if we are trying to deal with institutions, they have fairly significant systems, capacities, and so on, and they're trying to essentially address the problems of information asymmetries. Well, before you get the funding, they don't really need the funding. You can try and address information asymmetries by trying to do much better data analytics and really work with them to try and figure out, with their own data, how they can better respond. Because they have an incentive to try and expand their business and be much better at responding to consumer need. So we think that that's probably another pathway to addressing market failures, particularly for women. And funding is just one part of it. But I'll get into a bit more detail about how we do that.
Excellent. Thank you so much, Mr. Hussain. that funding is one part of challenges and prizes. So they run this competitively as well, but I'd like to emphasize the point that he made that funding is just one part. So now I'd like to turn to Mr. Tarun Sarwal from the ICRC, and I'm going to keep this up so that you can see who is speaking, to give a little bit of description of how they picked this particular format.
Okay. So thanks, Mohini. But first I want to say that I don't have a fund, so we're kind of distinct. I work for the International Committee of the Red Cross, and we're really, you know, fundamentally concerned with humanitarian work, and we actually have to, you know, really search deeply within our budgets to actually support innovation, which is what we're trying to do. We have many different models of innovation within the ICRC. We do our own. We have relationships, long-term strategic relationships with companies like Philips. We embed people within labs. We start hackathons, and we wanted, in a sense, to try and find a more kind of efficient way of doing innovation, and find a more speedy way of doing innovation, and so we came into the challenge domain. Now, one of the things that we're using it for is in a sense, to crowdsource innovation, so for our own use, and for our own use, but also for other humanitarian organizations. We have done one challenge, we call it a makeathon, and here, you know, based on very, very detailed assessments of what are the needs of rural people with disability, we set up a challenge. So very, very specific needs to have specific outputs that we could actually use ourselves, but also find a wider marketplace for. We recruited people to the challenge, we had 150 entries. We then whittled that down to 32 of the most appropriate solutions. We thought, we then supported the teams with mentoring in four different things, in business, in design, in engineering, and in the domain. And out of that, we got 32, we then cut down from the 32 teams to 16 teams, and then we provided them further support. And in a process of 60 days, people were able to go from an idea to a product like this. We thought it was incredible. So the people who actually are in the room came and said, look, what we want to do is a particular kind of wheelchair attachment. And in 60 days, we were able to come learn out who we were and come up with a product like this. So this has been our experience. We're now at the valley of death, but we do have orders for these products. That's how we're going to take them forward. And the government is interested in also kind of taking these on. So that's, in a sense, what we're looking at for the exit. Now, the methodology that we developed, we are trying, and in fact, other humanitarian organizations, which include UNHCR, MSF, WFP, and the Federation of the Red Cross, are all joining to use this methodology to do quick innovation. So that's well.
Excellent. And in our discussion with Tarun, we were talking yesterday that they're now thinking about looking at a challenge in Rwanda for refugees. So really looking at fast innovation through competitive funding. With that, I'd like to now turn it to our last panelist, Shalabh Mittal, CEO of the School of Social Entrepreneurs. He's just come in this morning. They had their first cohort decided, and he has some materials that we can share afterwards, announcing who their first cohort is. And they are actually looking at not even funding in terms of direct grants to entrepreneurs, but this whole more intensive mentoring process through competition, through challenges. So I'll let Shalabh speak a little bit on that.
It's just a quick background of what exactly School for Social Entrepreneurs is. So we are not a traditional school. So it just says school, but we are not a school. We are basically a learning program, and that's how we put it. We are a fellowship learning program. This was started by a man called Michael Young way back in 1997 in UK. And Michael Young had a very interesting background. He was basically left by his own parents, he was adopted by a very wealthy lady back in Dartington, and he was the Lord Young of Dartington. He faced a very challenged childhood, and had suffered iniquity and inequality in his life, and he was very disturbed. During his lifetime, he set up more than 50 social enterprises, out of which about 27 of them failed. And SSE was one of the last ones that he had set up. So what he basically did was he brought the entire experience of his own lifetime as to what he felt was the journey of a social entrepreneur and what that person or individual, you know, goes through, and what he needs is what is basically culled out into this, into the SSE's fellowship program. And that's what, that's how the SSE started in 1997. And since then, you know, we've grown, setting up more than 2,000 social enterprises across the world now. And we are just launching in India. We got our first cohort of 17 budding social entrepreneurs. So what we basically do is we invite applications for the first fellowship program, and we do a very rigorous, you know, process in terms of selecting the final cohort. So Mohini has been part of, you know, the final selection as well. So she knows what it really means. We don't advertise. We actually spread it through the word of mouth and through our partners network. In India, we are supported by the PwC India and British Council, and many of the partners are joining us now. And the entire program is basically focused on the entrepreneur. It's not on the enterprise. We firmly believe that if you've got the entrepreneur right, the bug is there, you know, the enterprise would happen. So many of the people who come with the idea, you know, initially with us, is not the enterprise that they create at the end of the program. And SSE model, the independent evaluations across the world say that about 98% of the students, they set up their enterprises while they're on the program, and 90% of them stay with the enterprise for more than 5 years. So that's what the legacy of, you know, SSE is, what we are bringing.